Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. You mean to wish me a good morning, or do you mean that it is a good morning whether I want it or not?
Please go away. Let me sleep for the love of God.
Beep beep.
If you know, you know. Something for the Natural Born Killers listeners out there. Hey guys, how you going?
Great.
Sorry. You threw it over to us a lot quicker, a lot faster than I was expecting.
It's great. It's great to have you back, Malzy.
Good to be here.
You too, Ben. Are you feeling better?
I am. I'm still a little phlegmy.
Oh, that's
but,
no good.
You know, that's a known side effect of it just turned out to be just the flu. I thought I had the Rona, but no Rona was present. Just the regular, average, normal, everyday flu.
If you missed the show last week, Ben was not at the desk. He did it over Zoom, which is where Malzy is now.
Woo, woo, woo.
We can't actually see Malzy right now, so I've got to sort of throw my hands to the screen as a cue. And I don't know what's going on.
What am I doing?
You did miss out on some treats last week, Ben.
I'm very upset. I was going to say,
I'm jealous.
I can't believe that they...
Now I'm going to turn off your video.
You ate them all, but you didn't.
No, I bought those yesterday.
Oh, I was going to buy some on my way here.
They're just for you, but I might dip into them too.
That's very nice. I don't need to talk for the rest of the show now.
Let me introduce us. This is Good Movie Monday, and this is a podcast. We come at you every single week without fail, offering up a special brand of nerdy cinematic ramblings. Seems like ages since we've had Malzy on the show because she skipped her last episode for some kind of bullshit reason. but we've got her back now and that's all that counts. What's news with you, Malzy?
Well, still nursing a premiership hangover / 40th birthday / fucking life. But I hate to say it, but it was well worth me skipping last month. I had... it would have been the night before, but it was the best day of my life, Collingwood winning the AFL Grand Final. It's not my first Grand Final that I've been to, but it was amazing. So, yeah.
Go join a footy podcast.
Might have missed me, but it was well worth it.
It's great to have you back.
Yeah, thanks. Good to be back.
So the music that's playing right now kind of alludes to the fact that our very loose theme on this episode is crime spree movies. And that is because our special guest on this particular episode is a director called Sean McEwan, whose new film is American Outlaws, and it's a true crime film about a bunch of siblings that go on the run and commit crime.
Rob Banks.
That's right, and stuff.
Bonnie and Clyde style, but without the sex.
And if his name sounds familiar, Sean McEwan, it's because he is married to Australia's one and only Tamin Sersek many things, Pretty Little Lies and...
Anything.
Yeah, many things.
Home and Away is what I... remember her from.
And he's known with her because they have a very strong social media presence, and I've already spoken to a couple of people about this guy and they were like, oh yeah, I know him, he's all over my Instagram and TikTok. So we actually had a really, really fantastic chat, and I can't wait to share that with everybody. We actually hit it off, and it's very rare that I have a guest say, oh, I'm coming to Australia and we're going to hang out. So he's my new bestie. Ben, scoot over. Make room.
A new permanent co-host on the show.
That's right.
Someone who actually remembers the movies he's seen.
Yes, exactly right. But before you shove that lolly in your gob, would you like to tell people what else is coming up on today's show?
Well, we've got the usuals.
Yeah.
We've got Jarrett with his physical media segment. We've got the Boneheads from Kentucky.
That's right.
Giving us their... I don't know what you'd call it.
I just call it the Kentucky version of us.
Version of us, yeah. They're giving us their opinions on films.
Mm-hmm.
What else have we got?
And that's about it.
Is that it? we've got the question that we've asked on social media. So we'll talk about that, about people's favourite crime spree.
Yeah, that is a new thing we're doing. And I do know for a fact, because I have been watching the stats, since our last episode, we have acquired quite a lot of new listeners. It must be one of the previous episodes that's done it, one of the guests or whatnot. But a lot of people listening now, that's what we've got for you. We do put it on social media every week now. It's a new thing that we do. We ask you a question, hoping that you will help inform the conversation on the show. So we'll get to that in a little bit. But of course, our website is goodmoviemonday.com. It's a pretty good website. It's got all of the stuff we do. Every episode we've ever recorded, all of the videos, lots of photos, and Ben's KFC diaries. That's there too.
You have to find it though.
That's it. It's an Easter egg. That's right. Melzy is here, and she's from the Melbourne Horror Film Society. Melzy, what's been going on with that?
Oh my God. Well, having just finished up October, unsurprisingly, it's been a bloody busy month. We had a bit of a different month. We had planned that we were going to be doing our usual one screening at True North, which is the second Saturday of the month in Coburg. And we're going to be doing two screenings at Long Play in Fitzroy North. And probably a week before our Long Play screening, we got a text message saying that Long Play had actually changed and was closing up for October.
Wow.
So I messaged True North and, yeah, we're like, oh, okay, all right. So I messaged True North and pulled in some favours there, and so we actually took over True North for the all three screenings.
Okay, you've turned into a bit of a robot there, Melzy. I'm just going to do the robot.
Oh, have I?
Yes. So if I heard you correctly, did you say that Long Play has closed?
Changed hands.
Just changed hands.
No, it changed hands. So it closed. It's actually reopening tonight.
Oh, okay.
Gotcha. And so we did the whole three screenings at True North.
Mm-hmm.
I showed Cabin in the Woods.
Awesome.
And then had a Buffy extravaganza with a full sing-along to the musical episode, Once More the Feeling, which was one of the best nights of my entire life. I was crying.
You've had a few of those best nights of your life in the last month.
Yeah, this is a banner year for Melzy.
Yeah, even though I'd say it's been a pretty shit year, actually. But yeah, weirdly enough, us can still get those best nights ever. The whole, like, it was just the entire place was singing. It was so fucking busy. It was amazing. And then, so we had three screenings at True North. Long Play will be back open at the end of this month, so we're back to normal.
Bowie's joined the show.
Melzy's dog, everybody. This is just like talking to David Tom Matthews all over again.
He heard about the sing-along, and he's like, oh, sing-along, all right. Whoa, whoa.
Why wasn't I invited to the sing-along?
I mean, I bought Ben some Scooby treats, but I didn't expect everybody to come. Awesome. So where can people find Melbourne Horror Film Society? What's it all about? How can they become members?
I just called in some backup. So in November, we're doing, we're back at True North second Saturday. So the 11th of November, we've got one of our members, Andrew Painter. He's he is going to be presenting Brain Damage for us. And then at the end of the month, we're back at Long Play, and I'm going to be presenting on the 28th, Tuesday the 28th, I'm going to be presenting Bob Clark's Death Dream.
Oh.
Which came out in 1974.
Very good. I could go on Bob Clark Marathon.
You can go to our website, melbournehorrorfilmsociety.org, or any of this. Oh, well, I don't know. I think we might be getting rid of Twitter, but Facebook or Instagram.
Sure. Excellent.
Yeah. I mean, if you're not posting porn pictures, there is absolutely no point to Twitter, I feel, anymore.
You get porn pictures on there.
Yeah.
Twitter's the only one that's still
open.
Yep. Well, I'm kind of in need of that in my life at the moment, because I was getting, like, literally every 20 seconds, I was getting pop-ups on my work laptop. Ooh. Of full-on porn, like, all day, every day. And then I got an email from work saying, your laptop has been infected or something. I'm like, they're onto it. They know. So I had to trade in the laptop for a new one. I don't bloody get my little porn pop-ups anymore.
Oh,
did you complain? Did you ask for them?
Yeah.
Can I have my laptop back?
I might have to stay on Twitter now.
Yeah. I do have a question for both of you. Last week, the show dropped The show dropped on Monday. Hmm. Tuesday, or Monday night, technically, was Halloween.
Yeah.
What movies did you guys watch? Did you watch anything? What did you watch on Halloween? Halloween's Eve.
Yes.
Oh, Halloween's Eve.
Hang on. What was it? I've got a fucking short-term memory. Keep talking while I bring it up because it's on my Facebook because I always do that.
I think, as I think I said at the end of the show, and I'm not sure if you left it in or not, I did end up watching Halloween 2.
Yep.
Which I hadn't seen before. And it,
oh, really?
I had not seen it.
Oh,
and
my God.
The funny thing, I have to say, and I kind of read a couple of reviews about Halloween 2.
Yep.
After it, and I agree. Like, if it was made today, you would cut out all of that nonsense at the start and just tack the hospital bit on at the end of Halloween and just make it a 2.5 hour movie, and it's fine. Because really, the whole beginning part of it, the only good stuff is Donald Pleasance constantly trying to explain, I didn't let him go. I didn't let him go.
Why won't you believe me?
What is this? And the cop. Yeah. He's my favorite. He's actually my favorite character in the film, is the highway guy. I'm the only one authorized to use the radio. He's literally pointing at, you know, and he points the...
But did you rate the movie?
Oh. It's fine. It's probably the least inventive of the Halloween
by the numbers
movies. Yeah. And it's, I find it really weird in that so many of Michael Myers kills in the movie are just because he happens to have taken people by surprise.
Yeah.
Like there's very little, you know,
suspense and
super strong shape.
It's very
stuff.
Different from the first one in that way.
But it's, I think it's the beginning of the kind of idea that he's like a supernatural force.
Totally.
Type thing, and he, you know, he's always in the right place at the right time, and he kills people before, you know, you don't even see a lot of the kills, you don't even see. And then some of them you're like, oh, just because you got injected in the eyeball doesn't mean you die. Like, what's what's happened to the doctor and the nurse in that scene? But
there's plenty of movies that they pull eyeballs out and keep going.
Yeah, I will say it does follow in the fine tradition of all good 70s and 80s slashes, in that it does have at least one scene of amazing nudity, which a completely gratuitous, which I appreciate.
Excellent. Well, I mean, there's no gratuitous nudity in the one I watched. I did Haunted Honeymoon, which I spoke about in my countdown last week, because we recommended like a lot of movies last week.
We did,
but yeah, Haunted Honeymoon, and it was as good as I remember it being. Like, it's much better than High Spirits, which was the other one I compared it to. Dom DeLuise plays like the Countess of a castle, and Gene Wilder told him to play it serious. Like, you know, you are this woman. You're not a man pretending to be a woman. You are absolutely this Countess, and he does it so well.
I was going to say, that, I can't believe that Dom DeLuise is capable of not overacting.
Yeah. It's fantastic, though. So that's what I watched. What about you, Mousy?
Well, Ruben and I have been watching the old Goosebumps TV series, so from the 90s.
Cool.
So we watched an episode, I think a double episode of that, because we went to watch the new one and, of course, put on Disney Plus, and he's like, his face has just dropped, and he's like, oh, I watched this with Daddy. And I don't ever like want to make you feel bad about that, but my face also must have dropped, because he was like, Oh, but I didn't watch all of it. I watched a lot of it. About 7 episodes. I think there's 7 episodes. And I was like, no, it's all right. So I looked up how I could get, because I think the 90s ones used to be on Netflix, but they're not anymore. But anyway, if you just search up like episode by episode on YouTube, they're all on YouTube. And we've actually been absolutely loving them. And then during the day, I took Halloween off work. Mm. So I ended up watching, due to your conversation last week, I ended up watching Tales of Halloween. I'd had the DVD for years and I hadn't actually seen it before. So I watched that and an episode of Chucky, I think the second episode of season 3.
What do you know, Ben? Our show's had an influence on somebody.
Yeah. Shocking.
Yeah. Finally.
As soon as I heard it mentioned a couple of times, I'm like, I've still got that sitting there. And so I watched three installments before I went for a run. So I was like putting it off. So I watched three, went for a run, came back and finished the rest of them. It's got great aesthetic, like incredible aesthetic. Really feels like Halloween, you know, shocker. Tales of Halloween feels like Halloween. But as we know from the Halloween movies, that's not always the case. So, yeah, very good.
Mm. Excelente. Ooh. Fantastic. All right. Well, let's, before we push on, just bring Jared into the conversation and see what he's got on the cards this week. Why not?
All right. Well, it's time to get physical, Jared. I want to hear your body talk, mate.
Oh, well, it's alive and ticking this week, thankfully, after a good week of, I'd like to say rest, but I didn't rest. I just worked through it. But, you know, I'm on the cusp of getting some time off and I'm very excited about that. And in the interim, you know, I've got some more special feature work to finish, but we won't announce any of that. Although you lads spoke last week briefly about the gate two, or I should say gate two, because there is no the before gate two. Yes, I've done the commentary for that one, and I ended up getting Tibor Takash to do the commentary with me, which was amazing.
That is incredible.
And yeah, there's so much insight because it is a hugely undocumented sequel. Outside of a handful of articles that popped up in genre magazines when the film was in production, when it came to release, you know, it got caught up in a big shuffle with a studio that, you know, was pretty much doing dodgy deals.
So here's a question for you. So, you know, for years that's been one of my favorite sequels, like horror sequels. Yeah. I love that movie. How did you research that one? Because there's not a lot out there on it.
There is so little out there. So that was the blessing, getting Tibor involved to do the commentary with me.
Yeah.
In terms of the commentary, though, I structured it so that I could talk about the troubled production and more so release history of the film.
Yep.
So that's pretty much the major thing. And yeah, and getting the odd anecdote here and there, like there was some stuff that I managed to get from the actors that they couldn't disclose that they were revealing because of everything that's going on in the States at the moment with SAG. So there's a few things that come firsthand that I can't actually acknowledge it's from them directly, which is a shame because God knows when that's going to end. It probably won't end by the time this thing releases, but yeah, it's a hugely undocumented film, and there is some really great stories that come out.
Was there any tracking down of Lewis Tripp?
Oh yeah, I've spoken with Lewis. Unfortunately, and do you know that Lewis lives in Melbourne?
Are you serious? That's why he's in Daniel Armstrong's fucking work.
Yeah, because he actually is good friends with Sean Montague, who is Kid Crusher.
Yeah,
and yeah, they'd been in correspondence for a little bit, and he turned up at a Kid Crusher show. I think it was just pre-pandemic maybe. And yeah, they sort of forged a bond and then they've collaborated on tracks together. And then Dan Armstrong's directed the videos.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, I got Sean to put me in contact with Lewis, and Lewis is lovely, very intelligent guy. But unfortunately the reason he's never been involved with any of the gate releases is purely because he's decided that he doesn't want to contribute in a capitalistic way to the releases. He doesn't mind talking about the films, although his memories, he said, you know, being 40 odd years on almost, are fairly vague, but yeah, he prefers not to sort of talk about them, but he's very proud of them. Wow. So it was a damn shame because I really wanted to get him for the commentary. I would have loved to have shot an interview with him.
He'd make a killing at conventions.
I know, absolutely. But yeah, he's living here in Melbourne. He's been living in Australia for almost a decade now. Was living in New South Wales, then moved to Melbourne probably about 7 years ago. So, and he's lived through the pandemic here. But yeah, so it's so bizarre to think that he's here in Australia. And to put everyone's mind at ease, he's according, you know, IMDb lists him is in Detroit Rock City, and he is 100% confirmed he is absolutely not in that movie whatsoever. He said, look, if I'm in it, I don't remember doing it, but I'd long left acting by the time that film had happened.
Wow. Well, Lewis, if this gets to you, there is a seat here at the desk. We would love to have you on the show to hang out.
Well, there's a very good chance, because this is not done, you know, for a capital gain sort of, there's, you know, so there's, no. You know, I will put you in touch with him and see.
There's no gain at all. No,
exactly. You hear that, sponsors?
I am curious, because you're doing just Gate 2? You're doing Gate 2?
Yeah,
because...
No, I do cover a bit of the gate on the Gate 2 commentary, and I certainly talk to Tibor about it, mainly about things that aren't sort of discussed, you know, really about the release and how he sort of took it, because it was a surprise hit, the first film, massive surprise hit. So we do touch on that. And then there are parallels between the two films that we talk about, because, I mean, they actually shot Gate 2 in the very same street they shot The Gate. And although, you know, the house isn't quite the same, it's a neighboring property. And anyway, so there's a lot of good stuff on the track. But we do touch on The Gate a little. But, I mean, The Gate release is stacked because it ports everything that was on the Vestron release in the States, as well as the sequel porting the very little content that was on the Scream Factory release. Yeah, right. I mean, I just don't understand how it doesn't get more love.
And before we move on,
great sequel.
On The Gate, was there any talk with Tibor about whether there was ever a Gate 3 coming?
Look, we did discuss it because there was multiple Gate projects that popped up at different points in time. He wasn't really directly involved with any of them. Mm. One of them was with Randy Cook, who was the special effects designer for both films, and at a point in time he was working on a third film, but it kind of came and went within the space of a month. It got announced in the trades and then he wasn't happy with the script, and then it pretty much died. Gotcha. Then of course there we talked briefly about the Alex Winter Gate 3D project that was going to happen in Germany, and I told him that Alex Winter had actually never seen Gate 2. So that was pretty funny. There's some really good stuff too, because I share a few anecdotes with him of things that he had no awareness of, related to some of what the actors have said since then. But anyway, it's all cool. In the track. It's great. Yep. I guess I better tell you about what's coming out this week on Home Entertainment. Unfortunately, it is not Gate 2. That's not coming out till mid-December. So you're going to have to wait a little longer for that one. But there is a huge release coming out this week, and pretty much this is the big release for the week, and I feel like all the other distros didn't want to go up against it because they know it's the one that's going to be taking the shelf space and consumers' dollars, and it's Barbie, and it's coming out in 4K, Blu-ray, and DVD, coming out through Roadshow from the Warner catalog, and it's a bit of a lackluster edition, in my opinion. There's only 6 featurettes on it, and I actually think this would be a film that I would like to listen to a commentary from Greta Gerwig on, and possibly with Margot Robbie. And they could even have Gosling there, Ryan Gosling, and maybe he just says very little throughout the commentary, so they can just keep him in his place. But yeah, it's a shame, and I don't see them double dipping with a like fantastic special edition of this one. But look, there is a retailer out there that's getting a steelbook, so at least there is a nice deluxe 4K package.
I can't help but think too that a major chunk of like the demographic after that one are not interested in many of the features.
Absolutely. I mean, but the beauty is at least it's getting a 4K, because this is a film that's going to pop in 4K with Dolby Vision. And the Dolby Atmos, again, guys, it's on the Blu-ray and it's on the 4K. So you don't need to get the 4K if you don't want that uptick in quality. You can get the Blu-ray and get that Atmos track on there. Yep. Anyway, that's the key massive release for the week.
Has anyone floated the idea of doing it in a double pack with Oppenheimer?
That one has been announced just in the last couple of weeks. It was one of those ones that they kept under wraps for quite some time. It's coming out November 22nd. So yeah, look, let's see. Maybe they can release a double pack down the track.
Or at least do the Deadpool style slipcases where they kind of cross over.
Yeah, that would be clever. That'd be clever. I mean, one's obviously Universe, the other one's Roadshow, so probably unlikely locally, but who knows, overseas.
They complemented each other. Both studios benefited totally from that. So
Everyone won. The only one that lost was that movie Cobweb that released in the US on the same day, Lionsgate. Anyway, so the other release that's coming out this week that's worth speaking about, not a massive release, but it's from Mad Men. It's coming out on Blu-ray and DVD, and it's called It Lives Inside. And this is like an American Indian co-production. It's played all the festivals. I haven't had an opportunity to check it out, but Mad Men did give it a wide theatrical back in September. So I'm quite keen to check it out. I'm really happy to actually doing a Blu-ray release of this one locally as well.
Yeah, I read an interview with the director of that one recently, and he's very, very much 80s horror focused, and that's where he takes a lot of his inspiration from. So yeah, could be excellent. A nostalgic little Indian infused, freak show.
Yeah, well, it's got great reviews, so I'm definitely keen to check it out. The other one I do want to mention, and I only want to mention it, it is on the inferior format. The only reason I'm mentioning it is pretty much to tell people not to go out and buy it, because they're being released. These two films that are being released in the double pack are being released individually a week later on Blu-ray locally. So go figure. But anyway, it's The Wraith and The Arrival are coming out in a DVD double pack from ViaVision. But literally next week, they're going to be coming out individually on Blu-ray in full-fledged special edition.
So don't get too excited that these are getting released at all, because there's
don't even walk in there and say, "Oh, I'd love to watch that this weekend." Just wait a week longer and get the nice, beautiful Blu-ray release. And the Wraith release again is a port of the US Vestron release, so it's got all the special feature content and is a pretty stacked release. So if you haven't got the Vestron release, definitely pick up the
essential for any respectable collection.
Absolutely, and you can go any back to one of
them. Has got to have Wraith.
Well, absolutely,
not Clint Howard.
No, not Charlie Sheen, perhaps. The only other thing I want to mention, gentlemen, is another bit of news, and it's from the ViaVision front. And I don't know if this one might get a rise out of you guys or not, but ViaVision are releasing a Three Ninjas quadrilogy pack in January. And I think this might be the first time globally that all four Three Ninja films have been combined, because we did have the triple pack in Australia, but it was sans Three Ninjas. And when I used to work back in retail, I remember customers coming in always requesting Three Ninjas and going, "We have this lovely triple pack of Three Ninjas Kickback and Three Ninjas Knuckle Up and Three Ninjas High Noon at Mega Mountain featuring Hulk Hogan."
Yep.
And they're like, "No, I just want the first one." You're like, "Oh, no, it's not available." And that was because I think it was under global distribution from Disney for quite some time. But now, obviously, it's no longer, and it's going to be included in a quadrilogy pack. So this is, I like the first film. Admittedly, you know, the second one was very average, and I never followed through on the last two, although I probably should have watched the fourth one because it's got Hulk Hogan, and I love Hulk Hogan in movies. When are we going to do the Hulk Hogan marathon?
So next year.
Look, I'm all keen. I'm keen for a Hulk Hogan. We should do a Good Movie Monday special and just binge all those Hulk Hogan movies. I've got a lot of them on VHS. Suburban Commando.
I've got that on DVD. We can even watch it in widescreen.
I've got the
I'm waiting for his new movie. Isn't his new movie like Daddy Daughter Day Trip?
Is that? Oh, I thought you were talking about the one he made with his wife.
No, he's very it's very funny when it comes to his daughter. If you look at photos and videos.
Oh, okay, that sounds uncomfortable. Okay,
did he suck her toe? Like was that the thing?
Oh, I think I do recall seeing something about that. Now
he's always got his hand on her ass and stuff like that.
Oh, that's very unusual. Very unusual.
Not for Hulk Hogan, it's not.
No, I guess not. But anyway, gentlemen, that's all I've got for you this week. So, as always, I'm going to count us down from 3, 2, stay physical. But yet we still couldn't do it.
Stay physical.
Until next time, gentlemen. We'll do it next
time.
Stay
physical.
Ha ha ha! You thought I forgot the Newsly bit, didn't you? It normally goes on the other side of Jarrett's segment, but here we are, and no, I haven't forgotten it. And I just kind of figure that you already know what Newsly is, and I don't need to remind you because that's how you listen to Good Movie Monday. Yeah? Cool. For those of you that don't know, it is a super app that you can put onto your phone, go to newsly.me and download it. It has all the podcasts from around the world, but it also has news articles from over 80 different countries, and it takes the highest trending news stories, puts them into the palm of your hand, all depending on your search criteria. In other words, things that you like, whether it's, you know, entertainment or sports or current affairs, whatever. And then it reads the news back to you in a natural human voice, which of course is very useful for when you can't read, whether you're driving, you might be running, whatever it is. And Newsly do love us, and they have a special offer for you, our loyal listener. If you go to newsly.me, download the app, upgrade to their premium service, you get a whole month of premium absolutely free. All you've got to do is use the exclusive code Monday without the O, MNDAY. Go to newsly.me, get started, listen to us that way. It is the best. All right, so here we are. This is what we do every week now. We put a question to Facebook. This week's question was, what are some of your favorite crime spree movies? I find that people are having trouble defining what a crime spree movie is here.
Well, it's hard because, you know, if you type in crime spree movie into Google and see what it comes up with, which I often do when these things come up, just as a memory refresher, it brings up slashes, it brings up everything, anything that has more than one crime. But sometimes it's just one crime. Like, this is not a crime spree.
I know. Well, this is the funny thing, because in my mind it is like a road trip on the run, on the lam kind of thing. That's where my mind is anyway, because you associate it like a killing spree with someone that's on the run.
Yep.
So that's where my brain went, because American Outlaws, the film we're going to be talking about in the interview, is about that. So that's the direction I went, but we had only two responses. They seem to be the two that hit every week.
Is it Brody and Jack?
We got Brody and Jack this week, yes, indeed. Good old Brody. He has said At Close Range, which is a fantastic one. That's the one with Christopher Walken and Sean Penn. And I do love that movie.
It's a great movie.
Ode to Revisit, The Hitcher.
Ooh, yeah.
Banger. And Natural Born Killers.
Yeah.
that's the go-to, I reckon. And then Jack, this is an interesting one. Jack only listed one, which was actually the brief. What's a good crime spree film? Tower Heist. Now, isn't that just one crime?
I've never seen Tower Heist.
It's good. It is good. Is it Brett Ratner? Yeah, and it's got Eddie Murphy and Ben Stiller. It's Eddie Murphy back in Beverly Hills Cop territory.
I was going to say, that's why I didn't watch it. You just outlined it for me.
I liked it a lot. Good movie. I don't know if it's a crime spree movie because there's just the one crime from memory. I don't remember any side crimes.
Yeah, I think so, yeah.
I did actually when you brought it up, I thought it was a perfect excuse to watch God Bless America, which I remember when it came out, and I couldn't find it for some reason. Mm. Like I wanted to acquire it for us to distribute, and it didn't happen. And I never actually saw it at the time, but I decided to jump and you know, God bless Tubi.
Yeah, 100%.
For having it. And I watched it, and what a cracker of a film.
It's a really good one. So it's Bobcat Goldthwait directed?
Directed by Bobcat Goldthwait, starring Joel Murray, my favorite Murray brother. He's the Murray brother from Mad Men, if that helps anyone out there. Who in Mad Men, he pisses himself. He gets so drunk, he pisses himself, which is a great / alarming scene because you think he's having a stroke.
Yeah.
But it's great. I think Maddie Hassan, who pops up in things like Malignant and stuff like that, has a bit part in it.
Mm-hmm.
As does the, I can never remember the guy's name, but he's in a bunch of stuff. And he's only in it for 2 seconds in that scene. Is it one scene when they're in the cinema and there are teens talking behind them and talking on their phone?
Yeah.
And then there's this another old guy who's like an older guy who's kind of sitting in the row in front of them, who's also talking on his phone, telling his ex-wife that he can't pick up their kid because he's flat out at work and he's working and he's clearly just sitting in the cinema, just being an asshole.
Yeah.
And that guy is in, like, he's in a boatload of stuff, but in one movie he plays like this, he's like the contract killer who comes into the cop shop. I think it's that Frank Grillo.
Hmm.
What's that Frank Grillo movie where they arrest him and he's wanted by the, and I think Gerard Butler is in it as well.
Oh yeah. Lost it. It's not Law Abiding Citizen.
No, it's not that one. It's because Frank Grillo's, I don't think Frank Grillo's in that one, but they're kind of kept in cells, and he's like Frank Grillo is like the mob accountant who's kind of turned, and so there's a hit put out him, but there's a great scene where this guy comes in and he's like a Candy Graham kind of delivery guy, and when the fat cop at the desk, is like, let me just have a look, and he kind of shoots him he stabs him in the back of the head, but it's just this amazing kind of scene because the guy, like, he's like, he kind of talks to the corpse, like, what's happening? Because he doesn't die straight away.
Yeah,
he keeps kind of wandering around the thing. It's just this great, whoever that guy is, I can't remember his name.
Well, maybe that can be the question for next week's Facebook.
Who's that guy?
Well, that could be the game. Like,
what, I think he might be,
name the things Ben forgot.
I think he might be, Sparks Nevada Marshall on Mars. I'm not sure if that means anything to you. If you're a fan of that Beyond Belief podcast.
You're talking like foreign language right now. It's all gibberish, mate. What about you, Malzy? Do you have any favorite crime spree movies? I guess Scream would be a crime spree movie. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I mean, obviously, like all of those sort of like Scream, Friday the 13th, things like that. What about Titane,
yeah.
It is, yeah. I mean, she's kind of like a serial killer typey thing.
Yep.
Yeah. I loved that film. So that Julia DeCornau, 2021. It's like I spent the entire time watching it being stressed out of my mind, worrying that it was going to go in a certain direction,
yep.
which I was very, very, because any sort of family dynamics really sort of stressed me out.
Mm-hmm.
And I was worried that it was going to go a certain way, and it didn't go that certain way. And I'm like, and I haven't watched it a second time yet, but I'm like, oh God, I can't wait to watch it a second time and not be so stressed about it. Now I know that, no, it's not going to go. I mean, it's fucked up. Like, don't get me wrong. But it's actually beautiful. It's actually a beautiful story, and the relationship that ends up forming in it. Yeah, didn't know if it was going to go to Wrong Town, but it doesn't really go to. It ends up just being, ends up being a beautiful relationship in there. But I mean, with someone with who is a serial killer and blah blah blah. But you know,
I wouldn't have even thought
two
of that
lost
one.
Souls kind of thing.
Yeah,
end up finding each other, and yeah, I really loved that movie.
I mean, the big one is obviously Badlands.
Badlands, that's for sure. Devil's Rejects. But some, I loved crime spree movies and kill spree movies when I was a teenager. And a couple of my favorite ones, there was The Honeymoon Killers.
Yeah, which was Tony Lubienko.
Yep, which was like 68 or something like that.
Black and white kind
Real art
by choice.
Film. Yeah, by
not,
choice.
Color was that's well right. and truly around at the time.
It is kind of Natural Born Killers for that era.
Yeah, but it's very much a kind of Hounds of Love type thing where
100%.
You know, they do this thing and then one gets jealous so they kill the victim and then move on to the next one kind of thing.
And very Badlandy as well, the way it's structured. The other one was Swoon. I don't know if you've seen that one. It's considered to be one of the early LGBT movies, and it was all about the Leopold and Loeb murders, which is the two gay guys that kidnapped a boy and murdered him and went on a bit of a crime spree. It's a fantastic movie.
What about Fun?
Fun.
Do you remember that one with Alicia Witt and Renee? It's not really a crime. I guess it's not really a crime spree because they killed the old woman in the
vaguely
in the house. Do you remember vaguely. That? Do you remember it was a big deal on? It was like a 90s art house movie. So Alicia Witt was probably straight out of Sybil.
Okay.
Maybe, you know, around the Four Rooms time.
Yeah, no, and, I don't know it, but I probably would if I see the VHS cover.
It's Renee. Renee, someone. She's Trisha from the sex therapist kind of writer from Mallrats.
Oh, okay.
Who you know has sex with all of the guys and then you know writes about all of the weird stuff that they do. Renee Humphreys,
right?
And she's in Sex Monster as well, the Mike Binder movie. but that was but it's two girls who kind of and that. I'm not sure if what it's based, if it's based on a true story, but I'm not sure if that's the true story that there's a lot of those ones where these two friends and anything that threatens their relationship,
it's kind of like Psycho and Texas Chainsaw Massacre are based on the same true story, but they're apples and oranges.
Yeah.
What about Perfect World, the Kevin Costner film with Clint Eastwood?
Yeah, with the little kid.
Yeah, that's a great one. The kid and Kevin Costner go on a crime spree.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
But it's like it's almost like a justifiable one, kind of.
Yeah, that's right.
It doesn't take much for...
Now, I always struggle with how to say this, but Prevenge or Prevenge.
The pregnancy one?
Yeah, Alice Lowe. I
haven't seen it.
Oh, it's so good. I screened it back when I was pregnant. 26, I did a pregnancy horror.
I remember you telling me.
Quartet of screenings. And the last one ended up, I was actually in labor. But
oh, my God. I was going to say, didn't that fuck you up?
No. Maybe fuck Ruben up. But that's yet to be seen. Actually, it fucked Bowie up. Well, no, the giving birth fucked Bowie up because he was like, and now he's still sitting here watching me now. He's still traumatized.
He made a meal of the placenta.
He was like, what the fuck's going on now? What's going on here? Alice Lowe directed it and wrote it and starred in it. And she goes on a payback like killing spree. And it's funny but dark, and yeah, it's really awesome.
Fun fact about Alice Lowe, and I'm kicking myself, but when I went to Fantastic Fest for the first time, which in 2014, which I think she was there for Prevenge, she was staying in the hotel room next to me. And at that stage,
it had been a long time since I'd seen Garth Marenghi's Dark Place. And so I didn't really know. I knew that she was Alice Lowe, but that didn't really mean anything to me.
Yeah.
Do you have joining doors? Do you have joining doors?
No. Oh. But I kick at myself now. Almost every morning I would see her. Just didn't say anything.
Oh, my God. Wow.
Yeah, at the homestay of all places, the homestay in Austin, Texas.
Hey, I'll just throw one more into the mix before we push on. The Purge, I think, is their crime spree movie.
Yeah. They certainly are.
You know, The Purge, the entire franchise is a franchise I really desperately would love to embrace and get into. And I do it every year I try, and I can never get very far. It just doesn't do it for me.
I saw Purge Anarchy first.
Yeah, which I think is the best one.
And yeah, that one really did it for me. And then I went back and watched The Purge and God Bless America. Is that what the last one's called?
Four or five or something. Yeah.
And three. But number two is the one I keep coming back to.
Yeah. And I can't get past that. I go to number three and it just gets really silly. Yeah. Then I went to the first Purge, which is the prequel one, and that's really silly. I can't do it, but it is definitely a crime spree movie.
Crime spree movie.
Yeah, yeah.
The movie I was talking about before was Cop Shop, Joe Carnahan's Cop Shop.
Of course, yes.
And it's Toby Huss is the guy. He's not Sparks Nevada, Marshall on Mars, unfortunately. that's someone else.
Brilliant. Do you have any more, Mousy, or should we move it on?
Nah, I reckon. Oh, Zodiac. That was another one that I was.
Oh, yeah, I guess any serial killer kind of movie like that.
Zodiac is a banger.
I do have going through that Tubi thing. as I always do when I'm on Tubi.
Tubi.
It's free.
It's free. Oh. It's great. It's got ads, but sometimes manageable.
Oh, yeah. Sometimes.
Sometimes, yeah. It's like the Samsung TV channels. Like they don't have the ads. They still make you take the break, but they're like, we don't have an ad here, but there should be one.
Just hang
so
tight.
You just wait. But I end up just adding a whole ton of stuff to my watch list and Copycat. Yeah. For some reason, Copycat, which is a big budget,
was a copycat movie. It was seven
Harry
clone.
Potter Jr. one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And, I just still remember from the trailer him licking that knife was so terrifying. And, I haven't seen that movie in years, and it's on Tubi, and I'm like, wow. I think I must have added it to my watch list like three times just in case it wasn't already there. I went, oh, I'll add this. Oh, I've just unadded it because I've added it just 10 minutes ago.
Well, because you added it, I'm going to add it.
Yeah.
It makes me the copy.
We should do a
watch party.
Yeah, watch party for Copycat. Right. On what's that service, Mel?
On the Discord.
On the Discord, yeah.
I forgot to bring up the Discord. The Melbourne Horror Film Society has a Discord. If you would like to join, just contact us on any of our socials or email.
Vous avez lu l'histoire de Jesse James? Comment il vécu? Comment il est mort? Ça vous a plu, hein? Vous en demandez encore? Eh bien, écoutez l'histoire de Bonnie and Clyde. Alors voilà, Clyde a une petite amie. Elle est belle et son prénom c'est
Bonnie.
À eux deux, ils forment le gang Barrow. Leur nom
Bonnie Parker
et Clyde Barrow.
Bonnie and Clyde. Bonnie and Clyde. Moi, lorsque j'ai connu Clyde autrefois, c'était un gars loyal, honnête et droit.
Il faut croire que c'est la société qui m'a définitivement abîmé.
Bonnie and Clyde. Bonnie and Clyde.
Qu'est-ce qu'on n'a pas écrit sur elle et moi?
On prétend que nous tuons de sang-froid.
C'est pas drôle, mais on est bien obligé
de faire taire celui qui se met à gueuler. Bonnie and Clyde.
Iceman se fait buter.
Qu'un garage ou qu'une banque se fait braquer.
Pour la police, ça ne fait pas de mystère.
C'est signé
Clyde Barrow,
Bonnie Parker, Bonnie and Clyde. Bonnie and Clyde.
Maintenant, chaque fois qu'on essaie de se ranger,
de s'installer tranquille dans un meublé,
dans les trois jours, voilà le tac tac tac.
Des mitraillettes qui reviennent à l'attaque. Bonnie and Clyde. Bonnie and Clyde.
Un de ces quatre, nous tomberons ensemble. Moi je m'en fous, c'est pour Bonnie que je tremble.
Quelle importance qu'il me fasse la peau. Moi Bonnie je tremble pour Clyde Barrow. Bonnie and Clyde. Bonnie and Clyde.
De toute façon, il ne pouvait plus s'en sortir.
La seule solution, c'était mourir.
Mais plus d'un les a suivis en enfer.
Quand sont morts Barrow et Bonnie Parker, Bonnie and Clyde. Bonnie and Clyde.
We just heard Bonnie and Clyde, a song selected by Benjamin Button over there.
By Serge Gainsbourg and Brigitte Bardot.
Yeah, that's a cracker.
Isn't it?
It is. And I love that movie.
It's a great movie. Mm. I like the stories behind it, especially like the premiere and stuff.
Tell us.
Oh, that was Warren Beatty went to tech check the movie before the preview, and they played the movie and the sound, all the gunshots were muted. And they'd spent a lot of time getting the gunshots right. And he goes up to the technician and he goes, oh, yeah, they were like really kind of over the top and stuff. So I turned it down and I fixed it all for you. So it plays right. And Warren Beatty's like, what the fuck? He was furious.
You know, that'd be a real stomach drop moment, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness. I wonder if that happened in American Outlaws. Don't know. I should have asked the director. This is the part of the show I've been really looking forward to. I want everyone to listen to this conversation because he's such a cool guy. Wants to hang out with me, man.
You just can't get over that, can you?
I can't.
It's like Glenn's found a friend. He's just so excited.
That's right.
Take anything out of this episode, take that out of it.
Yeah. what is to say, this movie, American Outlaws, it's the true story of a sibling gang called the Doherty Gang, like I said before, went on a nationwide crime spree, were chased by the FBI. It's very much Devil's Rejects without the grotesque horror. Also notable for being Treat Williams' final film.
Mm.
And we talk about that as well, and he's really good in it, and it's very haunting when you hear some of his final lines in the film. It's that's a bit sad. But it is out on DVD now, I believe, only a matter of time before it hits the streaming platforms as well. So I do hope everyone tracks it down, has a look.
That's that through our friends at Eagle Entertainment, isn't it?
It is indeed. So here you go. Have some of this. So, it's great to be chatting with you. So thank you for making time.
Oh, my gosh. Thank you for having me. It's a pleasure.
This is a great film. I was blindsided by this. I actually did a blind watch. I didn't know anything about it. Just went in and...
That makes two of us. I didn't know anything about it either. I'm just getting to know it myself.
So. I was so impressed. Congrats. It's great.
Oh, it means a lot that you'd watch it. And thanks for helping to, even have us on here and support. I mean, because not to sound cheesy, I know everybody knows this, but, you make an indie film. And, we had our own tentacles to it because it's based on a true story and all that. But... it takes a village. You need that support and to get it out there and hopefully tell cool stories and share. So thank you so much. That means a lot.
No, a pleasure. It's obviously based on a true story. Can you maybe just tell our audience what it's based on and why you felt compelled to turn it into a film?
Yeah, so it's called American Outlaws, and it is a fairly like American centric story, although I think a lot of the themes are fairly universal, which I think makes it kind of cool. But yeah, I mean, I can remember it was about a decade ago. It was in the news cycles. It was these three siblings that went on this cross country crime spree, and it had a kind of all the salacious bells and whistles of like, you know, the sister was like a former stripper now toting an AK-47, and they're like robbing banks and getting shootouts with the cops and stuff. But at the end of the day, and I think this is what really compelled me and drew me in, was the story really felt like it was about family, because there's a lot more. Once you started digging in and got past the kind of soundbitey aspect of it all, that it was, you know, there was much more to the story, as per usual in that. But, you know, Glenn, as news cycles go, and the story was out there, and it was like all in the zeitgeist for like the 7-8 days that it was occurring, and then it just kind of fizzles into the next thing. And so I remember kind of filing it away a bit, but then I had a colleague share with me this beautifully written by this great journo named Kathy Dobie, who wrote this for the GQ magazine, this article based on this. And the way that she actually laid it out, she'd done a lot of research and she got to know the real siblings, is it came across very cinematic in the writing of it, the communication of it. And that really pulled me in. And next thing you know, like myself and my business partners on it, we were like, man, there's like a film here. And long story short, it then took me down the rabbit hole of like, okay, I got the rights to the article, but then it was like, I need to go connect with the real siblings. Without giving too much away, they're each serving, I guess I'm getting a lot away in this, but serving 35 years apiece in three separate federal prisons. So next thing you know, I'm communicating with them and writing them and doing phone calls. And that's a whole effort in and of itself because of the situation. But I eventually went down and met with each of them individually in those federal prisons. And that was a whole experience itself. And it just goes to show like these things definitely take you, these journeys in the filmmaking process can take you to some pretty weird and extraordinary places. But that just opened up the whole thing, and then we really got deep in the development of it all.
That's incredible. I've read that article, and you're right, it is really a blueprint, isn't it? Like, it was really so well written and articulated and fleshed out. But I'm wondering, like, because to us in Australia, and I guess other places in the world, this sort of story of the Doherty gang is very much etched in American lore. Like, we know we've seen these sort of stories before. What was your intention making this film? Like, what did you want audiences to take away from it?
I think I've always, had my own fondness for that kind of like go west, very Americana kind of story. It does hearken to the, and forgive the highfalutin comparisons, but like the Bonnie and Clyde type of storytelling, even more recently, the Hell or High Water type stuff. And it does, it's really woven in the tapestry of that sort of American experience. I think for this one in particular was the two things. It was one that, even in a different way that some of those movies might have been, but it was really rooted in these interpersonal relationships, and specifically that this sibling bond that these characters had. And I think also, not to politicize anything, Glenn, but currently with the state of affairs in the world from a geopolitical standpoint, but specifically in the United States, I mean, you know, I think arguably, and most people would agree this, it's a very divided country. The United States is very divided. And you have like a huge swath of the population that feels very underrepresented, unrealized, not listened to. And again, not to politicize anything, but with that comes a frustration and a brewing frustration about like, look, I have a voice too, and I'm not being heard. And I think in a way, these kids were kind of byproducts of that, you know, experience. And from that, you know, not to say it justifies any of the actions or activity, of course it does not, but you start to understand like, wow, there's a systemic problem here. And through that systemic problem, you know, we as a society need to be aware of that and should be aware of what the cause of a lot of these problems are. And then on top of it, I personally am always attracted to, and I think audiences have really come to almost embrace this as kind of the nomenclature, kind of the norm, but the fact of these sort of like morally ambiguous characters, you know, these people that are not, look, they may have done not the greatest things in the world, made bad choices, but they are flawed. They're tragically flawed, but maybe there's some sort of understanding, or maybe we can explore that. And what were the circumstances that caused them to make the decisions and these choices that they had, not to justify again the actions and choices, but to try to understand everything around that. And I think that became a really fascinating, aspect of the journey in and of itself.
100%. I feel like there's there's a lot of these films starting to bubble up to the surface that really ask the audience to look at their own morality, to look at their own humanity. And this is definitely one of them. But at the same time, it's a slice of entertainment, and it is very entertaining. And, you know, some similar movies just to you know, draw the audience in if they've never heard of it. You know, you go right back to Badlands and Bonnie and Clyde, even Absolutely. Natural Born Killers and Devil's Rejects. As a creative, where did you draw your influences from, like, to make this as much a piece of entertainment as it is an important story?
I think all of that. I mean, you never want to think that there's a glorification of any of these things, but there is something about that. Like, I go back to that statement that sort of, you know, go west, young man, go west, young woman, like a freedom. One of the big themes about this is, like, they're kind of idealized but askew understanding, interpretation, and desire to find freedom. And to understand what that is. So when you put yourself as an audience member in that place, it's like, what would it be like to just, like, you know, buck the system and get on the road and go, you know, what they did is they took their road atlas and threw all the cell phones out the window and the credit cards out the window, and they went just like their granddaddy taught them to do, and they went through the deep, dirty south of it all and got off the beaten path, and they kind of discovered the undiscovered country through their experience. And all those things, there's almost a romanticism to it, because it's like you're taking the bull by the horns and you're Jack Kerouac-ing it, and you're just going for it, you know? And I think that was really appealing. And then, look, you know, again, it's not about the violence of it, but there is something about, like, people taking control of their own destiny. And again, it's askew. There's no justification for it. People, while they didn't get hurt, obviously could have. That's a horrible thing. But there's something that, you know, again, it sparks something. It sparks and triggers something, I think, from our own perspective as Americans, as humans, as moviegoers. And I think there's something very intriguing about that, and going, man, what it'd be like to just take control of my life. They went way extreme with that, or attempted to.
Yeah.
But to just, you know, I'm just gonna, you know, I'm gonna be led by my own devices and go for it, you know. And I think that to me was, I was really interested in exploring that space.
Yeah, it's complex too, because they are lost within themselves as they travel as well. So I'm gonna circle back to the logistics of, you know, the cross-country element of the film, but I just want to touch upon the cast, because the cast is excellent, all seasoned players. And I know from what I've read that you, I believe, knew India for a long time before this.
Sorry to interrupt you.
Yeah.
No, actually, I really had the pleasure of meeting her through the audition process.
Oh, right.
I was aware of her work. Okay. And she was just extraordinary through the entire process. And I think the end result is her performance is just outstanding. But no, it was a new relationship.
Yeah. Oh, that's awesome. So was this cast entirely through audition?
Yes, it was. All the main key cast were. I was really fortunate. One of my dear friends, who's, I think, one of the foremost casting directors in the industry, John Papsidera, who, you know, again, he works in much bigger worlds. He does all of Taylor Sheridan stuff and all those series, and Chris Nolan and Sam Raimi and all that. But really has his finger on the pulse of young talent. We were looking for really that, you know, that young talent, but that has that chops. And it's a very actor-driven, talent-driven, character-driven piece. So that's everything. I mean, that's the backdrop, the foredrop, the, you know, everything is through the lens of the actors' performances. So we knew we needed that. Wanted them to be, there be a bond there, and that we could believe that they're siblings and that they're able to develop that. And I think we felt that with that. And the rest was all through the audition process. The only person, and I want to mention her because I'm obsessed with her and she's amazing. I have my own personal connection to it, is the actress who played the woman in the farmhouse, Tess Harper, who's an Oscar-nominated actress.
Yes.
The whole old country, No Country for Old Men, et cetera, et cetera. And she was in Tender Mercies, Robert Duvall.
Yep.
So I knew Tess before. Okay. And again, she's one of those people that she populates the world in the best way possible. And so there was that. But yeah, I was really, really proud of the cast that came together for this, because they're all, like, really wonderful actors. I mean, and you just, you know, what a blessing.
Yeah, absolutely. And they are. And I'm glad you brought up Tess, because I've loved her for a long time. She's fantastic. But then also you just factor that with Treat Williams. You've got him. How did you get him on board?
Well, again, that came through the suggestion of a relationship to his agent, who was very supportive of the project. So we got very lucky there. And look, I mean, you know, the sad news is that Treat was unfortunately passed away and was killed in a motorcycle accident just some months ago.
Mm.
So that was devastating. I actually had spoken to him. I'd stayed in really great contact with him, spoken to him like a week or two before he passed away. You know, that was shocking to us. I think the only sort of good of any of it is that, you know, we found this way to really like kind of, you know, celebrate and honor his legacy through the film coming out. We just had a wonderful experience at the Boston Film Festival. Sorry to sound like I'm blowing our own horn, but
you should though.
Won a number of awards there, and best film, and et cetera. And they gave a Lifetime Achievement Award posthumously, of course, but to Treat for his performance and also his body of work. And his son was able to attend, and that was amazing. I had not met him. I heard a lot about him, never met him in person. I got to and spent the weekend with him, and that was just amazing. So it really, you know, for a terribly tragic situation, it was, you know, what a blessing to work with somebody like that. He was a real legend.
Mm.
And he brought so much to the film and was so complimentary even going into it, and was just, for me as a, you know, a kind of a newer filmmaker, if you will, although I look a little long in the tooth these days. What is all this gray coming out of my beard these days? it was really outstanding to get, you know, his sort of stamp of approval to be excited to be in the project.
Yeah, awesome. And I mean, yeah, I he's someone we've talked about on our podcast a lot over the years. So I believe, if I'm not mistaken, correct me if I'm wrong, this was his final film.
Yeah, you know, we're at, as we understand it, this is what we're told.
Yeah.
I think it is. I know it's, you know, one of his final films. I think it is. I think he did some other TV stuff that's kind of more in that streamer space. So that's how we understand it, what we've been told. But I'm not, to be honest with you, I'm not 100% sure.
That makes it all the more profound, though, because there is a moment in there where he ponders death in the film. And, like, that sent chills through my spine watching that. Like, in one of his final moments, too, like, on screen.
Yeah, look. His character, and he plays this federal agent that's chasing the kids.
Yeah.
And he was really an amalgamation of a number of different characters, to be frank.
Mm-hmm.
But he represented that kind of more cynical voice about his perspective on the youth of today and, you know, good and bad and law enforcement and society as a whole. And so he had a lot of very, like, sort of existential fatalist kind of, you know, ponderings through the character that he portrayed. And it really did resonate when you go back and look at it now and realize, you know, here's a really, you know, grounded character, and you know, to know what happened to Treat and stuff, and he's no longer with us is, you know, it's very shocking and impactful when you watch it again with that in mind. Yeah.
Completely, just adds a whole nother texture to it. I'm going to circle back now to the technical stuff. So much of the film is taking place inside a moving car that is on open roads in traffic at times. How do you direct that?
The great question. I've had the fortune, and even the new movie that I'm starting working on has a lot of what we call road work in it.
Mm-hmm.
And my film before this film had a lot of, it was a road trip movie. And this was, for all intents and purposes, a road trip movie. I feel like I have a lot of that in my film. And I don't know if that's because maybe in some latent way, and I should talk to my therapist about this, am I always like I'm wandering myself or something, looking for something, I can't find it. But all joking aside, yeah, listen, it is technically, especially, look, let's just be frank again. It's an indie film. It's a, you know, a lower budget film. You know, mm-hmm. we're not, you know, working with all the bells and whistles of a Marvel film and all this. So we have to find clever ways. I had a wonderful crew that just had a plan and we executed that plan. But no, we did. I mean, I think it added to the realism in the sense we got the, I call them the kids, but the three siblings, mm-hmm. The actors who played the siblings out on the open road, and we got a chance to just go and kind of see America. I mean, we shot in Louisiana, and we shot a little bit in Texas and also in California, but we really got to go through that kind of deep, dirty South of it all and take that in and absorb it. And so from a technical standpoint, yeah, I mean, look, you know, we, you know, you do have to worry about the environment and, you know, making sure the cameras are stabilized, et cetera. And we were very fortunate to work with some really great and talented people that helped with all that, and that we could, you know, we could get it done.
Filming across all of that distance, though, does that, like, is there a lot of red tape involved with all different county lines and different permits and things like that?
Yeah, I mean, do you want me to tell you the inside baseball of it all, like the inside scoop of it all? I mean,
are you going to tell me you just did it all illegally and just, you know, threw caution to the wind?
I mean, there was a little bit of that, and I think that's the exciting part of what draws us as filmmakers into be pirates and, you know, miscreants and circus barkers and all that kind of stuff. So, you know, look, I'm not, I don't want to say I'm proud of that, but sure, well, of course you do that, and that's kind of the exciting part because they're like, you know, goes back to like, oh, we're guerrilla filmmakers, here we go. But we were, but this is now going to take the air of what I just said. So we were really fortunate because we shot that particular stuff in Shreveport, Louisiana, and there's a wonderful military base or Army Reserve base that's for training their transportation aspects. And, you know, it's also contained, you can, what we call kind of own the whole area. So we worked with them and we got to just run for miles and not have to worry about closing down roads and, you know, all these kind of things because it's, you know, very self-contained and also private in that way. So that helped a lot with that, especially, again, I keep harping on this, but for our, I feel like I shouldn't be saying this, but for our budget level, you know, we couldn't shut down, you know, city blocks and do all these things, but we were able to get in there and make it look like we were doing a lot for very little.
I like that you say that stuff because it just gives people a reason to appreciate the film so much more because it does not look like your typical cheap movie. It's a really good looking film. And you mentioned Taylor Sheridan before. This is cut from the same cloth of a lot of what he does.
And I love that stuff. I mean, look, that's I don't even have a right to compare to that kind of stuff in Taylor's work. But I mean, I love that stuff. I love that Southern Gothic feel. I'm from the South myself. I'm such a Southerner in deep South that I married an Australian because that's the South as you can get for us. So, I'm teasing. But no, but so to me, like a lot of the stories that I tell are very much immersed in that and based in that. And I think, you know, Taylor Sheridan in particular has, you know, he creates a world of that culture in that setting. And I think not purposely necessarily, but I think, you know, my stuff, you know, is kind of akin to that and cut from that cloth too. And I'm very inspired by his work. So yeah, I agree with that 1,000%.
Totally. Now before I do wrap this up, I ask a lot of people this question, people that I talk to, what type of movies do you gravitate towards in your downtime when you're not making movies? Like, I don't like calling them guilty pleasures because who should feel guilty about watching a movie, but where do you go?
I don't want to give the canned answer, but I fucking love movies. I really do. I was just talking to a friend about this. I realized, like, okay, my, not to say too much, but my background was not the best upbringing as a child, but movies like raised me even more than TV. I wasn't a big TV watcher, but I was one of those geeky guys, and I still am. I'm a complete geek. I just love cinema. I crave it. I love movies. I love the experience of going to the movie theater, sitting there with other people that you don't know, but we're having this collective experience, like all those things we all know and probably what we all love. But so anything, I mean, like anything that's good or interesting or partially good, but you can appreciate something or what was going on. So I love all that stuff. But I mean, I love the greats. I mean, I love, you know, that 70s filmmaking style. And you go back to the Coppolas and the early Scorsese's and even Spielberg and all that kind of stuff is just like, it's what I, you know, it's what inspired me as a kid. It's like, I was in awe. It's like, so all of that stuff is, you know, I mean, it's everything. And, you know, in a way, I hope, and I don't want to end on a downer note, but I hope we don't lose that. You know what I mean? It's like, there's still so many great stories. This is what I love about, if I'm allowed to talk about my humble perspective on Australian filmmaking and filmmakers is, I still feel like there's a real sensibility for that. And why I love Aussie filmmakers, I know it's a very blanketed statement, but I feel like it does still have those kind of roots to, you know, even the filmmaking styles of, you know, the 70s in Australia and even how that was occurring at the same time in the States. And I feel like Australian filmmakers, you know, have this really distinct voice that still comes through, that's unique. And that, they've been able to maintain. Obviously there's amazing, huge filmmakers that have, you know, come from Australia, but like everything in between, even from an indie sensibility, if you will, or that kind of smaller space, there's still, and that's exciting to me. It's like there's so many people that have such great stories to tell, and that's personally what I love. That's why I want to try to do, and we all connect like that. So again, sorry for the kind of ambiguous answer, like I'm not getting
specific.
I just love it all. It's just incredible.
Not only are you talking my language, but you're talking the language of our listeners, so I'm sure that in and of itself will convince people to go and track your film down and watch it, and I hope they do. But thank you so much for taking time out to chat. It's awesome chatting. I could probably go on another 2 hours if I'm being honest.
Oh man, anytime. I would love to talk to you. You've been incredible. You're super dope to talk to too. So thank you, and thank you for your time. It means a lot. Thank you.
And let's get you back on when your next film comes out.
I can't wait. Listen, that one is very special. So, and we have an incredible cast. So yeah, I look forward to. I'd love to stay in touch. So thank you.
Let's do it.
Welcome to Bonehead Weekly Fun Size, and this week we're talking about crime sprees, coppa.
What is going on with your voice? It sounds like you're drowning.
Oh, probably. I have a little bit of the Halloween candy. I put a piece of Hershey in my mouth.
That'll do it. Yeah, yeah. By the way, Australia has better chocolate than America.
Why? What makes you say that?
Because American chocolate sucks ass.
You don't even like fireworks. I don't need to say anymore.
What's your crime spree movie?
Well, my crime spree movie is a guy that kills a lot of people. I guess that's crime. We were walking back. It's like you talk about mass murders or crime sprees or whatnot. But I actually, one of mine is I want to talk about 1968's Targets, given to us by Peter Bogdanovich, released by Paramount Pictures. A lot of it comes from Corman, and it stars Boris Karloff. And he plays an aging B-movie actor who basically ends up throughout his day in front of this guy named Bobby Thompson, played by Kim O'Kelly, who's killed his wife and his mother, and he goes on a brutal shooting spree. It's basically a knockoff of several things that were going on in America at that time. And what they did was they used some movie footage that they'd already shot for Corman so that they could do this low budget. Bogdanovich had worked for Corman, and it's still an interesting picture. It works so well in so many different levels. The great Sam Fuller actually helped Bogdanovich get the screenplay in order so that they could make it work, and he refused to take credit. I don't know if a lot of people know that or not. That's one of them. But if you've never seen Targets, check it out. It's actually it's right up there with The Body Snatcher, of one of my top two or three of Boris Karloff's performances.
I'll go ahead. I had a hard time with this because I like caper films, but usually it's about one event, so I didn't want to pick any of those type of crimes. So I had to go with murder as well. Oh, you feel bad for liking him, but by the end of it, you kind of root for him. At least I do, which probably says something about me. The Devil's Rejects. Like, they get to the end and you have seen everything they've done, but when Freebird starts to play, man, you just hope maybe they'll somehow get by. And then there was that follow-up that said they did, and I regretted hoping they got by. Devil's Rejects is such a good movie, though.
I agree.
It is all about killing and crime sprees and a hunt for them and vengeance on the part of the law that wants to get them, is what makes them oddly sympathetic by the end, because the people out to get them are just as brutal as they are.
Quite right. There's really no good people. Maybe the mom, where he steals her clown car for official clown business. I mean, that may be it. I mean,
Why you don't like clowns, I'll come back and kill your
whole family.
Family.
We'll edit that. The Australians don't use bad language.
So I'm going to talk about a movie. So I disagree with you all.
You're going to talk. you're going to talk about a movie.
Yeah.
I
had no transition. I am going to talk about a movie that is about something that happens in one night, but it is over encompassing of several different things happening at one time. I am going to talk about 1991's The Taking of Beverly Hills, starring Ken Wall and Matt Frewer. Also, not to mention Robert Davies, Harley Jane Kozak, Lyman Ward, Michael Bowen.
Now you're just reading the IMDb.
I am, but these are all people, character actors, that if you look them up and you go, oh, it's that guy.
You only needed to say Matt Frewer and Robert Davies.
So Ken Wall is a quarterback who is in Beverly Hills celebrating his wins, and Matt Frewer is just a cop that nobody cares about. And then all of a sudden, a chemical leak happens in the town of Beverly Hills, and everybody has to evacuate. But what the people don't know is that this chemical spill is fake, and all these henchmen and villains are coming to steal all the gold and all the jewels that are in Beverly Hills. What? And it's all about, and all that's left is Ken Wall and Matt Frewer to stop them. It is a great movie. It's only an hour and a half, you all. It's one of those movies that kind of got forgotten in the early 90s just because it flew underneath the radar.
You rewatched this late recently, right?
Oh, yeah. I bought it.
You bought it?
Yeah.
Physical media.
I just remember liking the soundtrack.
I loved the movie when I was a kid, and I watched it back, and I admittedly go, you know, it's not as great as it was when I was a kid, but I still loved it. It's still just an entertaining film.
Chad, I think actually the film stayed the same. It's you that changed.
Yes.
Oh my God, that is so poignant.
All y'all can go to hell in this segment.
Kidneys.
That's been Bonehead Weekly Funsies. Oh, I said it like a dumbass.
You did.
You know, last week, Ben, we recommended 40 films on the show, and if you actually count Malzy, Jarrett, and the Boneheads, it's over 50 recommendations on the one episode. You'd think that we'd be plum-tuckered out of recommendations by now.
I just hope that everyone who listens has watched every single one of them.
Yeah, well, I mean, what are we here for?
You got one tick from me. You got one.
Yeah, that's what we, you know, we got. One, but that was from the week before. I think that was from, was that from last week or was that from the week
last
before?
Week.
Oh, no, it was last week.
Week.
See, she knows what she's on about. Yeah.
I don't. I remember that it was Jarrett's. Jarrett was talking about it. I just couldn't remember. When we had that conversation.
I think it's safe to say we don't get tired of recommending movies.
No, look. What's the point of being a movie nerd if you can't, you know?
And look, the truth of the matter is, if we weren't recording now, we'd be talking like this anyway.
Yeah.
Just yeah, Melzy. I'm going to throw it to you first. What do you recommend this week?
Okay. Well, after all that whole preamble, this has probably been the most difficult that I have had in having a a movie to recommend, basically because I've been busy. And nothing that I've watched is really, I've probably talked a bit about them anyway, and also I'm going, some of the things I'm going to be showing for screening, so I don't want to give it away. But I, and then of course I talked about a few movies last week, but I, so today I quickly, very early in the morning, I jumped on and watched something been meaning to watch for a long time. Reuben Guthrie.
Oh, the Aussie one.
Yeah, the Aussie one.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah. So, starring Patrick Bramall, who I love.
Who's in everything.
Yes. Written and directed by Brendan Cowell. Aussie film 2015. It's about basically a cockhead, like who works very high up in
Ben
advertising.
The movie.
He is, you know, award-winning. He's not a Hollywood, kind of a, in the vein of like a Hollywood type of person. And he, his life is a party. He's got like a, you know, he's meant to be 29, but I don't know how he's passing for 29. But anyway.
I bet there was a little bit of this in that.
Yeah.
A little covering the mouth of 29. We can't see Melzy right now, but I bet she's doing that.
He's got like a, you know, a 20-year-old model girlfriend who ends up leaving him because he's, you know, they're having one like celebratory party and he jumps off the roof and breaks his arm and... She says to him, if you go sober for 1 year, you'll, you know, like come and find me overseas or whatever. So it's a story of him battling staying sober for a year.
Mm.
And this is why I find it a bit difficult to really recommend. I recommend it. I definitely recommend it. It's an Aussie film. Patrick Bramall's awesome. Alex Dimitriades steals the show. He's friggin' hilarious in it. I think I have a bit of a hard time with alcohol-related things. So some of it I'm like, yeah, I don't know. I just don't know what sort of message that it's really putting out there. But it's quite enjoyable.
Excellent.
I'm guessing, so have either of you seen it?
No. It's one I know very well of, but I just,
it's on Stan.
I've got it on DVD or Blu-ray somewhere. I just haven't got to it.
But it's an easy film to watch and quite enjoyable. I don't know.
Awesome. We'll definitely do that. I've gone down the Aussie route as well.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So I told you about this one as well. There's a new documentary on Netflix called Last Stop Larimer.
You did tell me about it.
It is a true crime doco. It's an American doco. It was made for HBO Max. Is that what they call it over there? HBO Max?
I think that's the new...
Yeah. But Netflix here have picked it up. It is a feature-length documentary that Netflix have happened to break into two episodes, which I found kind of ludicrous. Oh. I don't know why you would do that. But it is a story unlike any other. It takes place in this very tiny town of Larimer, population 12, I think it is, or 11.
It's my kind of town.
But one of them gets murdered. So then you've got like 11 suspects or 10 suspects.
It's like an Agatha Christie story.
And it is...
And then there were none.
The interesting thing about this one is that they've got so much archival footage of this town from before the murder of the guy that was murdered. So like it might have been an ABC camera crew had gone there for some other reason to talk about it being a small town. Predominantly Anglo-Saxon community with no indigenous people there, yet it's so close to Darwin and Catherine. And so they've got this guy that was murdered on camera. And it's just fascinating because you suddenly realize that this town of, you know, what, 10 or 11 people, they're not as tight-knit as you would think, and they've all got secrets, and they practically will hate each other.
Yeah, right.
And so then they start to unravel what could have happened to this guy.
But I would imagine that the Carlton United Brewery loves them.
Well, the pub is central to the film. Like, the pub is the focus of the film. And I'm not going to say anything else about this story other than definitely check it out, but the possibilities of what happened, like, you pretty much have an outcome at the end. You know more or less what's happened, but there are some things that could have also happened that they put out there to think about that are just the stuff of Hollywood legend. Like, it really is hard to dive into without giving any spoilers away, but the characters in this are incredible. There was only one person in town that refused to be on camera, but the camera crew filmed him anyway. He just doesn't talk. And they are just as ochre as you can get. But, yeah, look, it's a colourful, hilarious, scary documentary that I highly recommend called Last Stop Larimer, Murder in the Outback.
Oh, fascinating.
Nice. It is so good. Ben, your turn.
My turn. Look, I actually got through a lot of films this week, surprisingly.
Surprise, surprise. yes.
I love that meme. But I think it's got nothing to do with the theme of the show or anything like that. But I want to get back to my roots and recommend. And I didn't realize it was on YouTube. It's been like a grail film for me to find because it never got released here in Australia. But I finally tracked it down. It is Jim Wynorski's 1989 classic Transylvania Twist. And I did immediately when I was. Like, I think I was like 10 minutes through it, and I didn't realize you'd seen it. And I just texted each other, you've got to watch this. You would fucking love it.
I'm still going to watch it again because you sent me the link and said you got to watch this. I had it on VHS, and I don't know what happened to it. I picked it up in Canada. Maybe I left it in Canada. But, yeah.
I mean, it's basically Jim Wynorski's kind of Dracula. It's kind of the best way to describe it.
I didn't know he directed it either when you said it to me. I know the film, but didn't know it was his.
And it does, look, the opening of the film is this, is like a young kind of Red Riding Hood type walking through the forest, and then she gets stalked by basically Leatherface, Jason, and Michael Myers. And they all together, all three of them, and they track her into, like, she runs into a cave and they follow her in, and then there's like some crashing and banging, and she comes out and like wipes blood off her face, and there's like amateurs. Like, that's the kind of, you know,
Did she do the twist?
She doesn't do the twist, but Pinhead also turns up in it later on, and it's like a comedy horror. The joke with Pinhead is like, you know, I don't care what people say. These pins are uncomfortable, which is pretty funny.
I do remember that. Oh my god!
But it's basically this. Terry Copley stars in it, and she plays Marissa Orlock, whose estranged father dies and leaves her. And she gets summoned to his castle in Transylvania, the Orlock family castle. And like her kind of boyfriend tags along for the ride. And there, when she gets there, her uncle is already taken up residence. And her uncle is played by Robert Vaughn from Man from U.N.C.L.E. And he's got three lovely vampire daughters played by Wynorski regulars, Tony Naples, Becky LeBeau, and Monique Gabrielle.
It's all coming back to me because he dresses up like classic Dracula with the red cape. Like.
Yeah, and it's just like a really fun, there's a bunch of musical numbers where they make fun of the fact that there are musical numbers in the musical numbers. Ace Mask, another Wynorski regular, plays the Van Helsing type character. It's just so much fun. Like, it is that kind of 80s kind of, you know, mockumentary style comedy kind of, you know, direct to video drive in kind of, you know, film that Jim Wynorski was kind of famous for.
What a shame you couldn't put that on last week's list.
It
would have gone on there, surely. It would
have definitely gone on there.
It reminded me of, there's another movie with all the classic monsters, not Monster Squad, but they're all played by little people. You know what that was? And what's that, that little person, you know? Is it
Billy Barty?
No, the one from Bordello of Blood right at the start.
Oh, Phil Fondacaro.
Yes, Phil Fondacaro, I think, plays Dracula or something like
that. Perfect casting.
Yeah, it might be a Charles Band production, but it's all of the classic Universal monsters played by little people.
That sounds like a great movie.
Yes. Like, I may even have the DVD, but it's definitely somewhere on like maybe Prime or
that,
something.
That reminds me of another movie that I have to watch, which is the Under the Rainbow, which is the, you know,
oh yes,
the making of Wizard of Oz.
That's terrifying.
With all of the
running amok in
running
the
hotel. Yeah, all the little people.
And they had to like issue a public apology for that film, I think,
because they're all like horn dogs.
Yeah, but the director has, there's a documentary about it, and the director's come out saying that it is the one regret of my career making that movie.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, like because the backlash came thick and fast then, not now. Yeah. Anyway.
But it was based on an actual, like, he's not embellishing things. Like, that's kind of, they were notorious on the, I mean, but they were, it was a big, I remember hearing something about Judy Garland saying that the, you know, she was being constantly sexually harassed by the, by the Lollipop Guild in the film. They were very handsy.
Mm.
The midgets.
I mean,
the little people.
Yeah, we're going to get in trouble. Melzie.
Oh, she's done this.
Do you have anything to add before Ben wraps up the show?
I thought you'd made a mistake. I thought you were like, did I talk so long that you'd forgotten Melzie had already done her recommendation? No.
Yeah, don't make me recommend another one. I was struggling enough with that one.
No, we're about to wrap the show up, and I just wondered if you want to add anything.
Yeah, I'll see you next month.
All right.
Get on the Discord. Get on the Discord, get on the socials, get on the website and the emails and find out what the Melbourne Horror Film Society is doing. That's about it.
Do
I'll
it.
Try to watch some more stuff by next month. Oh, it's nearly my favourite time. Well, actually, it's a toss-up between whether Halloween or the Christmas festive horror time is my favourite time. But
well, yeah. we're going to have to dust off that old Silent Night, Deadly Night 5.
Hell yeah.
The toy maker.
Of course.
Hell yeah. We were texting about it the other night, weren't we, Glenn? So we must be getting in the mood.
Yep. Every year without fail.
Without fail.
Thanks.
I actually forgot to watch Hubie Halloween on Halloween, so I'm going to have to make up for that.
You will.
At Christmas time.
We need a Hubie Christmas movie.
Yes.
Oh, he could be the new Ernest.
Be so good. He can go to camp. He can go to jail.
Oh, there's other places he can go too. All right.
Should Ruben watch Hubie Halloween?
Yes.
Because he loved, whatchamacallit, that his dad said that I looked like with my haircut.
Little Nicky.
Yeah,
I love that. So
it's cut from the same cloth as Little Nicky and Waterboy.
Yeah, sweet.
Awesome. Thanks for being here, Malzie.
Thanks for having me.
Ben's gonna take us out.
I am. Look, as I said earlier, I did manage to get through a lot of films this week, and I finally caught up on my Guy Ritchie, which is great.
Yep.
I watched Operation Fortune Ruse de Guerre, which was great, and The Covenant. And I actually, as a companion piece to Covenant, which is Guy Ritchie's kind of movie starring Jake Gyllenhaal about a soldier who kind of has to go, who escapes a near-death experience in Afghanistan, but then has to go back to save the interpreter who saved his life from the Taliban. And I watched Kandahar, the Gerard Butler version, pretty much of the same. It's not really the same story, but it's close enough. They're very... And if you know me, I do not watch... I have no real interest in watching war in Iraq type, war in the Middle East kind of movies. It's just not my bag. If I'm going to go watch a war movie, it's going to be World War II.
Longest wrap-up ever.
Yeah.
But I did watch The Covenant, and as much as... And I didn't really rate the film too much, but there is a song that plays through the credits... that has been with me ever since, and that is the song we're going to play now. I assume, because you didn't actually confirm that it came through.
We're good.
It is Alex Ebert's Truth.
Oh, is it? Yeah, it is. See you next week.
trying to trick me into doing battle. Calling out fake up, wanna get me rattled. Wanna pull me back behind the fence with the cat. Building your lenses, digging your trenches. Put me on the front line, leave me with a dumb mind. With no defenses, but your defenses. If you can't stand to feel the pain, then you are senseless. Since then, I've grown up some different kind of fighter. And when the darkness comes, let inside you. Your darkness is shining. My darkness is shining. Have faith in myself. Truth. I've seen a million number doors on the horizon. Now which is the future you're choosing before you gon' die? And I'll tell you about a secret I've been undermining. Every little lie in this world come from the vine. Say you're my love, say you're my home. Till my chin back, slit my throat. Take a bath in my blood, get to know me. All out of my secrets. All my enemies are turning into my teachers. Speak up, like blind in no way dividing. What's yours or mine when everything's shining? And your darkness is shining. My darkness is shining. Have faith. Yeah.